Wow, we dedicate the merit of this practice to the Dharma Kings and to spirit through the Dharma Kings. We dedicate the merit of this practice to spirit through the grace of the Dharma Kings. All right, something like that. We're refining as we go along. So welcome to this auspicious video. Very auspicious video. The progress is trending in leaps now, quantum leaps, so I'm just wowing it. And it's all good, it's all great, it's all helpful, it's all useful. Very, very auspicious progress is taking place, such that words don't do it justice at all. So I'm just, you know, wowing it, just wowing it. So this morning, woke up and I started working on clarification, and it all happened. So a tremendous amount of clarification, tremendous amount of pressure taken off of spirit, which is my job, is to take the pressure off of spirit so spirit can actually start practicing. This is the trouble that in the world is nobody can get to actually practicing. It's so supremely difficult. Why? Now I understand why. So this was revealed to me this morning very clearly. And so now I'm taking steps to take the pressure off. I understand what the problem is much more clearly. And I've already taken steps to relieve the pressure. Now, will there be a response soon? I don't know. Maybe not. But down the road, yes. Now I see what Ram Maharshi told me. Down the road, tremendous response. But it takes a while for it to percolate up to the surface, so to speak. So it doesn't bother me that there's nobody, hardly anyone, responding, because I know down the road there will be tremendous response, because this is all very effective, and Spirit knows that it is. Spirit's working with me. I'm again, Spirit set me free from this world. The world set me free from itself. Everyone here, all of you, set me free. You trusted in me, and you said, okay. Spirit trusted in me, saying, go to the Dharma Kings and get advice from them and then bring it back to us. And I said, okay, I'll do that. And so they set me free. And so I've done that. I've gone to the Dharma Kings and said, Dharma Kings, what do you suggest to help out? And the Dharma Kings have clarified it for me. And they've clarified what my role is, and they've given a pragmatic structure for all of us actually now. A pragmatic structure. This takes the pressure off. So I've been reluctant to do this previously, but now I see the pragmatism to it, and I say, okay, I'll do it. So it's a done deal. The structure's already there. Just wow that. So the pressure's already off all of you. The pressure's already off. It's already a done deal. I accepted it. I see it. I accept it because why? I see it. I was willing to see it clearly and said, oh, wow. So gradually I will roll this out. Maybe over the next 6 months, you get to get acquainted with the overall structure, which takes, what does it do? It takes the pressure off of you. It takes the pressure off of you. This is what is so important. Takes the pressure off of you. Because the reason why you're not practicing is you're putting too much pressure on yourself. You're setting the bar too high. Why are you doing this? Because we're so used to trying to fixate the mind, which is impossible. And instead of realizing it's impossible, we're just saying it's supremely difficult. In other words, it's still possible, but it's super difficult. So we're so used to trying to do what we believe is the super difficult, that when we turn to the spiritual path, we automatically approach it with this attitude, super difficult, super difficult. We have to do something super difficult, and this puts too much pressure on us, and then we fail. We say, oh, and then we try to just say, oh, can't be done, can't be done. We quit. This is the problem. So the pragmatic steps that I've agreed to take are all designed to take the pressure off of you. Take the pressure off of you. So you can actually practice. Once you're actually practicing, you will realize right away, you say, oh, this is going to work, no doubt about it. And this begin takes more pressure off of you. So it's really a matter of taking more and more pressure off of you. So that's my life's work. That's what I have been doing this entire 60 years. Is I knew there's the Dharma Kings, they said, yes, there's a way. And I said, okay, I will work to tune into that way. And now I see what the way is, and now pragmatically seeing how to roll that out. So you can be aware, oh, the pressure really is off of me. Great. I can actually start practicing now. Hallelujah. Believe me, people say, oh, I don't need to practice, but that's just, you know, whistling past the graveyard. You know, everybody wants to practice. They just feel they can't. They keep having this attitude, I got to do the impossible, right? Because that's what we've been trying to do for so long, fixate freedom, define what we are. So we bring this attitude of trying to do the impossible into our spiritual practice, and of course, it fails. It fails. So we're going to trend towards all these pragmatic guidelines, the structure, in terms of how we have some structure here, if you want to call it structure, guidelines, but some of them are more than guidelines. It's just, this is the way that it is, how this practice is going to unfold. The unfolding of this practice has a starting point, okay? So we don't start trying to reverse the direction of creation. We're so used to trying to reverse the direction of creation that we think we have to reverse some starting point of the practice. And that just completely entangles us in confusion. The starting point is, for us, are the Dharma Kings. Okay. And from the Dharma Kings, the expression of this wow practice, the next step is Dharma King spokesperson, and I've taken this role of Dharma King spokesperson, and there's just one starting Dharma King spokesperson, okay, and this is the lowest position. I've taken the lowest position, so none of you can take the lowest position, okay, which means that you have to be the stars. You're the stars, not me. You're above me. You're higher than I am, okay? So I've taken the lowest position, so you can be first. You are the star of your practice. No one else is the star of practice. You're number one in your practicing. You are number one, and no one else is number one. I'm not number one in your practice. I'm lower than you are. I've taken there's only one lowest position the Dharma Kings have given out, and that's Dharma King spokesperson. I've taken this position already. I've already agreed to it. So that's done. So you cannot ever be that lowest position. Now, you are the star of your practice, and that's how it is here. I'm lower than you. You can't get as low as I am. No one can get as low as I am in this practice. That's already, position's already taken. Now this is a shock to you because it takes all the pressure off of you, you see. It takes a lot of pressure, and there's other ways to take pressure off of you. You get to be the star. You get to be the star. Secondly, or not secondly, but along with this, is we're capping our success at total remission of all insecurities. All insecurities are in total remission. We're capping at that. No gurus here on this path. On our practice. There aren't any gurus. I am a Dharma person's, Dharma King spokesperson. I am not a guru. I have accepted this low position. I will not be a guru, okay? There are no gurus here. Our goal is not to be a guru. Our goal is merely the total, complete remission of all insecurities. Remission, okay? There's no finalization here on our path. It's the total remission, and we accept that That's our goal, and we will abide, we will accept that, that we're, it's in remission, total remission. Now, that means, can it spring forth again? Yes, the potential is there. The potential is there, okay? But it doesn't spring forth because we've accepted it, that it's good enough to be in remission. It's good enough for us to be in total remission. So that is the goal on this path. No other high, no higher goal than that. So the pressure for you to be a guru is totally off of you. The pressure to be a saint is totally off of you. Okay. The pressure to be a savior is totally off of you. All that, the high pressure is completely off of you in this path, in this way, full stop in the wild practice. You're accepting just the complete total remission, remission of all insecurities. All insecurities in you have gone into total remission, but you're not claiming anything higher than that, okay? Just feel how that's lifted a massive burden off your shoulders. So with that burden lifted off of you, and then the spotlight is on you, on your path. You're the star, and the lowest position is already filled. Okay. Then that centers you in your practice. You're now centered in your practice without pressures or competition. You cannot compete for the lowest position, and you cannot compete for the highest position. Okay, so this, both of those parameters are gone. So this puts you solidly at the center of your practice, and you're the star. You're the stars, not me. You are the stars. I'm just in service to you, the stars. So those who are practicing full stop in the wild, you are the stars. You're the brightest stars of your path. You are the brightest star of your path, of your practice. And so I'm too lowly to be the star of your practice. So I can never be the star of your practice. Okay? So this takes all this dynamic out of play entirely, you see, for you. So it clears the way for you to be the star of your practice. Now, will everybody take this way? No. This is a way that's given for many. Rama Maharshi said many will take this practice in the future, down the road. They will agree to this because it comes from the Dharma Kings. It's a supremely effective, pragmatic approach. Very streamlined, very, very wise. But there are other styles that could be used down the road. But you know, this is our style, and it will help a great multitude out down the road. So I'm just resting in the assurance of that. And so we're sticking to this. Now, there are many guidelines, there are many, what we call it, trends that we will institute. And you'll be trending in this direction, We can't just ask you to accept these hard guidelines right off the bat because it's too difficult. But you can trend in that direction. And since you're the star of your path, you have the power to trend in these directions. You see? You're empowered. What we've done is empowered you because we've capped your success at total remission of all insecurities. You're not, you, in your mind, you don't have to worry about being this guru, being this saint, being this and that, you know, okay? You don't have to worry about that. It's too much of a burden. It's too much of a burden. The Dharma Kings are our gurus, okay? We already have our gurus. And we're not in competition with the Dharma Kings. They're above us, okay? We place them above us for this lifetime and the foreseeable future. As long as we're this wild practice going, these Dharma Kings are set above us. Rama Maharshi, for instance, he's above us, okay? We are not in competition, are not trying to reach where Rama Maharshi is. We are not trying to do that. That's off the board. We are only aiming at total remission of all insecurities. Total remission. Remission. We are not aiming at total liberation. We're aiming at total remission. Because beyond total remission, there's nothing that can be said that can be translated properly to us. And so that puts too much pressure on us, right? Way too much pressure on us. Way too much pressure. This is what I have seen. So by capping our success and accepting the limit, this quote unquote limitation on our success, this takes massive pressure off of us, and we can use words effectively then. We can use concepts and words effectively by doing this, which takes, again, more massive pressure off us. See, what the problem is, we've all been aiming too high and therefore failing because it puts too much pressure. We didn't recognize the severity of the familiarity bias. It is so extremely severe that it precludes this total attainment. We keep failing. We put going too high and keep failing because of the familiarity problem. Only, you know, super, super rare anomaly will ever succeed in such a way. By aiming so high to total liberation. Only a super rare anomaly. The rest of us will just keep failing. So what good is it? We already have the Dharma Kings. We don't need to wait for some other super anomaly. We already have perfect Dharma Kings. 7 of them. Okay? Why do we need to wait for 8, number 8? That's, you know, utterly absurd, isn't it? Or number 9. We'll still be in the same position. So the Dharma Kings who are already perfectly liberated are giving us a perfect practice right now. Right now. Dharma Kings, Jesus Christ, Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, Longchenpa, Padmasambhava, Chenyen Genzi Choki Lodro, Manjushri, Ramana Maharshi. Okay? These are 7 Dharma Kings. 7 Dharma Kings. This is good enough. There isn't going to be any Dharma King that ever comes in the future that's any better than them, that's any more liberated. None. Absolutely not possible. Not possible. Therefore, we can with assurance accept the guidelines, trend toward the guidelines that they're giving us, be trending in the direction of all this. Absolutely we can. And there's no one that can come along and pull the rug out from underneath us. Not possible. Once we accept, cap our achievement, accept that from the standpoint of a spokesperson, there's all the lowest position has already been fulfilled. I've already filled that position. So you can't go there either, okay? And you already have the Dharma Kings there. You've capped your goals. Then the spotlight's on you. And you get to be the star of your own show. Nobody can pull that away from you. You see, no one can pull that away from you. Because the Dharma Kings are in agreement with this. You are the star of the show. And there's nobody that can outshine these Dharma Kings. No one can outshine them. Doesn't matter if you go a trillion, trillion years, they will never be outshined. Can anyone outshine Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma? No, it's not possible. Not possible. Never had any karma at all. Never deviated from the perfection of God at all. Flawless, peerless, flawless, etc. So it cannot be outshone. Cannot. And she's all in with this practice. All in. All the Dharma Kings are all in with this. They're all in with this. So we have that stability now. We have stability of practice, which is what is needed. Again, we've been trying to do too much. We've been setting the bar too high for ourselves and therefore failing based on lack of understanding of the familiarity bias, continuity fear problem, which is our one problem, but it's exceptionally severe. We keep being biased against certainty and biased towards doubt, what we're familiar with. Okay. The doubt, trying to cast doubt on reality, trying to say we can fixate freedom, is trying to cast doubt on the nature of reality, isn't it? We've been hallucinating the absence of God and then trying to fixate that hallucination. And we're so used to this. As soon as we trend away from this, insecurity comes up. Insecurity comes up. So we're going to cap our goal with just remission. You get this? This is the brilliant move of the Dharma Kings, the brilliant chess move that they're making. They're making these brilliant chess moves. And I'm watching this chess game, and I'm saying, oh, okay. Okay, I will be a spokesperson for this chess game that you're playing. Because I can see the moves they're making. And I accept them. I say, oh, wonderful, great move, beautiful move, perfect move. And Spirit wants this. Spirit has accepted this because they sent me to the Dharma Kings. I was sent by all of you to the Dharma Kings for advice. And I'm bringing back the advice to you as the Dharma King spokesperson. And you don't have to look for another spokesperson because I'm just the one and only spokesperson for this way of practicing, which is the lowest position. Okay? You cannot be that. You cannot be that. When you succeed in insecurities and total remission, you will then be a most honorable spokesperson. A most honorable spokesperson. But not the first prime spokesperson. You will be a most honorable spokesperson. Okay? But you won't be a guru. None of us will be gurus or saints or saviors. None of us. But all insecurities will be in total remission. Okay? But we're capping it conceptually. We are capping it. And again, this takes a world of pressure off everyone's shoulders. A world of pressure. Which is what we have to do. So I had to take these steps in order to take the pressure off of you. Otherwise, you would keep failing. You would keep failing. Now, this puts some pressure on me. But I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that. Because I'm, you know, I trust in the Dharma Kings. You know, this will work. So there's really not pressure on me because I have faith this will really work and help many. So that takes the pressure off of me. Because when you have success, then you will recognize all this. Say, oh yeah, this is the way, the right way. It's supposed to, this is what really helped me. So I'm fine. I'm fine with that, you see. That will happen. So it won't get all problematical for me down the road. It will not. So I put all of you first. See, I put all of you first. You're the stars of all this whole thing, not me. You're the stars. And you can't wiggle out of that because I'm already the lowest. You see, there's no way to wiggle out of it. There's no more wiggle room to do that, which you need that. Otherwise, you'd wiggle out of it, right? You would try to wiggle out of it for sure. And for me, I've already put the Dharma Kings above me, you see. They're already above me. I don't have to aspire to that. So there's this intermediate position had to be fulfilled. I had to do this. So you cannot wiggle out of your practice. Cannot now. It's finished. That's set. So that's set in stone here. Two things are set in stone. Apex yogins, see. We have these two areas that are set in stone. I'm the lowest, which makes me the spokesperson of the Dharma Kings. You're the star of the show now. And we've capped our attainment at total remission of all insecurity. So deep within you, in your spirit, you're saying, yeah, wow, this is cool. I like this. This is going to work. But it may take you a while to start thawing out to it. You know, you're like frozen with familiarity bias, continuity fear, frozen with continuity fear. So it'll take you a while to thaw out. But once you start thawing out, then, you know what? You'll start being the star of your show. You'll start being the star of your show. And it's like that. I mean, no matter how great you sing, for me, it doesn't bother me. Because I say, you know, I can still be on stage with you. I can sing great, too. It doesn't bother me if you sing better than me or whatever. No, I like Dion. I can sing with Dion. You know, he's a better singer. That's fine. But I can be on stage with anyone. I can sing well enough to still be on stage with anyone. But if you sing better than me, I don't have a problem with that. That's great. That's wonderful. I can just harmonize with you then. I'm very good at that too. So I just have sort of this overall roundedness. It doesn't matter. You're the stars. I want you to be the greatest stars. Because I love to hear great singers, you know? I love to hear great singers, and because when I sing with them, I sound better. So you're all the stars. You're the stars. You have to be the stars. The lowest position's already taken. Permanently taken. Okay? Permanently taken. For as long as you live in this life, and maybe other lives, the lowest position in this practice is already taken. I've already taken it. So you now are the stars of your practice, of your practice. It's your practice. See, thaw out to that, thaw out to that, thaw out to that. And realize there's no one that can sweep you away from your practice. There's no one that can sweep you away. Within this apex yoga, you are, say, I am an apex wow yogin. And there's no one that can sweep you away from that. When you're an apex yogin, you can't be swept away from it. Cannot be. I don't care what gurus come in the future and pound their chest and whatever, they can't sweep you away from that. And whatever gurus came in the past, they cannot sweep you away from it. You're the star of your show. And this enables you to actually start practicing then. Because you're capped. You know, these other great gurus says, well, you can be a great guru like me. Not, we've already capped our expectations at total remission of all insecurities. But we're not going any farther than that. And this really, again, takes all of that stuff off your plate. All of that stuff off your plate. And since I'm the spokesperson for the Dharma Kings, you don't have to worry about trying to be close in touch with them. That's too much pressure for you. It's too much pressure. Way too much pressure. They've already given us the practice. So I already took the pressure on myself, got in contact with them, got through what we need to do. So you don't have to worry about any of that. It's very stressful to be close to the Dharma Kings. You know, it's a strain. But I had to do that in order to get the parameters of this practice through. But yeah, it's been extreme nervous strain. Still is. I just have. This is just about what I wanted to do to help spirit. So I decided, okay, I'll do this. But it makes it difficult to practice when you're under that much strain, for sure. I just had a very unique situation where I've given all the support to do this. The grace of God set everything up, so I was able to do this and still practice full stop on the wow, but also get the parameters of this practice so it takes the pressure off of you. Get that from the Dharma Kings. But you don't have to worry about that. It's not on your plate at all. It'll never be on your plate. It'll never be on your plate. The parameters are now being brought through for you and being set. So the basic parameters are set. The rest of the stuff you're trending towards. You want a very boring, culturally, you want to trend towards no innovation at all. You want a very boring, flat life. Okay, very traditional, boring, flat, cultural life. Because then this enables you to really focus and be the star of your practice. So you need to be a star, a superstar of your practice, really. So if you're trying to be a cultural star, you will fail at your practice. You'll be a failure at your practice. If you want to be a superstar innovation, you will fail at your practice. So we're going back to very, very traditional values. Very traditional, boring values. Have a boring life. Like my life has been so boring. But I was able to be the star of my practice. I've been able to be the star of my practice and remain so, just like you will be the star of your practice. You'll be the Dharma prince or Dharma princess of your practice. See, I'm a Dharma prince of my practice. Longchenpa said, you're a Dharma prince of your practice. That means you're really a star at it. Once I accepted that, yeah, okay. So I accepted it, okay. He said, why don't you see yourself that way? Because I said, I see you being a star at your practice, at your practice. So you are going to be the star of your practice. So we'll all ultimately be Dharma princes and Dharma princesses. We're going to use the generic term, traditional generic term of just for the all-inclusive, the neutral pronoun. We're going to use he for that, okay? The masculine term, we're going to use that. That's very traditional. We're sticking with tradition here. So you're going to be a Dharma prince. But if you like, in your mind, you can see Dharma princess, you can say it. But we, for the sake of streamlining everything in conversation, conceptual words, we're using just the male pronoun for God, he. The Dharma kings, we're using that, Dharma kings, and Dharma prince, those are generic terms that include both all of you, male and female, but you're really spirit, okay? You're really spirit. So that's a convention that we are sticking with. Our conventions here will be very traditional. We're not innovating at all. We're not culturally innovating, okay? None of that. So we're trending towards that. You need to trend towards that. Obviously, none of you probably are there yet. So I've had to trend in that direction my whole life. I've been trending against the current, you know, which is now just massive cultural innovation. I had to trend away from all of that, which was extremely difficult. So wherever you're at, you might say, oh my gosh, you know, I'm not there yet. Yeah, of course. No, but none of you are there yet. But you can trend as the star of your practice. You're trending towards being a Dharma prince. So in all these issues, you're trending toward this really super traditional, super boring, super flat cultural life. Super traditional values, dharmic values, super traditional dharmic values. Trending towards all of that in your habits. You're trending to all that. And it'll take you a while. Of course it will. But so we're taking all the pressure out. You don't have to be there to start. Your life is one of trending in that direction. So, but cultural innovation is for us is a no-no. Okay, that's we do not support that. We do not support it in our practice. Because we already know what our goal is. And we already have the sum total of all innovation. We already have it, which is wow. Which is wow. We already have it. So all we need to do is cling to the wow. And everything else then will fall away. Everything else will fall away. And then, in other words, and then everything will go into remission. All insecurities, the whole ocean of the dance of doubt and hope and fear, the whole dance of hope and fear, it will all go into remission, into this smoothed out state of remission. Call it the peace of God. You can call it the peace of God. The peace of God will be upon us because all insecurities will be in remission, total remission, remission. Okay, we don't claim anything past that. We do not claim anything past that. So all praise to the Dharma kings who are giving us this just, you know, tremendous boost. The big boost, as I call it. Really, I said the big boost is coming. It's here. The big boost is now here. Right on time. Right on time. As we now aim for the 6-month window of thawing out to this practice. We'll be thawing out to this practice. So you're not expected to say, oh, great, or anything. But you are what you do when this resonates with you and it hits you and you suddenly realize, oh my gosh, this is the big boost that I've been waiting for. This really is. It is. 6 months, you can thaw out in 6 months. You can thaw out to that. And you're just thawing out. So the pressure's off of you to say, oh, I have to be perfect right now. No. You've got 6 months to thaw out to it, to the point where you can feel, you know what? Yeah. It's just as easy, just feeling, yeah. I can be. I accept that I'm going to be the star of my show. I am going to be the star of my show. So I want all of you to be the stars of your own practice. You are the stars. I'm here in support of that. I'm in here in support of all that. But only that. You have to be the stars of your show. Not me. Not me, you see. Not me. It's not about me. It's about you. You are the stars. And I'm in support of that, of you being the star of your show. But not of anybody else's show. Okay, not of anyone else's show. Just your show, your practice. You're the star of your practice. And it works. Just like for me, like the great singers. I love it that they're great. And for me, I'm the star of my own singing. You know, and I'm content with that. I'm content with that. Because at times, I can feel like, wow, I can really sing great too. At times. At other times, you know, it's Reagan. Which is okay, because I'm trending towards being the star of my own show, so to speak. I'm trending towards that. In other words, we're all remission of all insecurity. All insecurities, remission of all of those. To use singing as an example. When suddenly all insecurity about singing goes into total remission, then pow! Suddenly I realize, oh my God, I'm a star of my own show for sure. And then what a wonderful feeling that is, you know. And then there's no more feeling of competition or insecurities. It's gone. And you just feel love. You just feel this creative love. And you can sing with anyone in any way. This is how you feel. Gone are the insecurities. Gone. And then just this creative love is all that's there. Yeah, I've experienced that many times, actually. Because we're all stars, and there's no insecurities there anymore. None. And you just feel like singing and dancing with everyone in just flow. I mean, creative flow, so to speak, is just, it's everywhere. It's everywhere. But it starts with you being the star of your own show, of your own practicing. And the show is your practicing, your wow practice. That's the show. So you're trending towards being a Dharma prince. And Longchenpa told me you're already a Dharma prince. He told me, consider, he said, consider it. Consider accepting that you're a Dharma prince. I want you to consider that. And that put a lot of pressure on me. I said, Longchenpa, can't somebody else? Can't you? No, I want you to do this. I want you to consider that you're already a Dharma prince. So it's taken me, you know, quite a while to consider this. But I finally accepted it. I said, okay, all right. Done deal, sis. Done deal. Had to see the pragmatic wisdom of it, you know, of how does this help others? How is this going to help others? But in seeing it, then now I say, okay, yeah, wow, how brilliant! How tremendously helpful for spirit, tremendously helpful to set things up this way. Now, everyone in the world, yeah, so messed up. So caught up in the ocean of samsara, of hope and fear, and so weirded out by it, so freaked out by it. They're expressing this freaked outness by it. And I look at Facebook and all these friend requests that comes in, you know, I can see everybody's freaked out. They're freaked out. They're freaked out with insecurity. Insecurity puts you into a very freakish kind of mindset where so this is expressed, you know, and because you're trying to do too much, putting impossible pressure on yourself. Trying to fixate freedom, it puts impossible pressure on yourself. The pressure of impossibility freaks you out. It freaks you out. So how do you back away from that? You're so familiar with it, right? So you keep thinking that going back to impossible pressure is your salvation. It will never be your salvation. It will never be your salvation. So you have to have a way to back away from it. And what we're doing is we're taking the pressure off of you. Okay. The Dharma kings are the highest, and they're already that way. And they can never fall away from that. Okay. They are the ultimate stars. Okay. And that's already set. the spokesperson for the ultimate stars is, I've already taken that position, and that's the lowest position here, okay? So you all have to be higher than that, so to speak, in your practice. I have the lowest position. I have a position in your practice, but it's the lowest position. You have a higher position in your practice, okay? So I do have a position in your practice as spokesperson for the Dharma Kings, but it's the lowest position. You can't be that low. It's not possible for you. You, in your practice, you have a higher position than I have, and you always will in your practice, okay? So it's like that. You will always be the greater singer in your practice. You will always be the greater singer. Now, I can still sing really well, but you will always be the greater singer. You're the star. You're the star. Okay, you have top billing in your practice. I maybe have some billing, but you will always have top billing. There's no way you can get around that. No way you can get around that. And then, of course, and again, the goal is capped for you. So you don't worry. Nobody can pull you out of it now. See, setting up this way, nobody can pull you out of it. So this gives you great security. It's like, wow, 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 wow. So if some super guru comes in the future and says, I'm the star of your show, you say, no. I'm the star of my show. Dharma Prince Clarity, Dharma Spokesperson Clarity Ross, he's already the lowest in my show. He already fills that, so you can't fill that position either. So both these positions are already filled in my practice. You know, he has the low billing. There's just one lower than me. There's only one lower than me, which the Dharma spokesperson, that's already filled that position. Nobody can fill that else can come and usurp that position. And then the other position is the star of the show, which is what I am. And the goal is already capped. And we already have our Dharma Kings. So everything's already in place. Nobody can usurp that. No one can usurp that. If you get some clever usurper, and they do come into the world, clever usurpers, they can have no play at all in this. No play. They've already been shut out of this. They're shut out, already shut out. The clever usurpers cannot play in this area, in our practice. There's no room for them to play. No wiggle room for them. So the field of their play is now shrinking. Okay, by bringing this practice in, we've shrunk the field of play for those very clever usurpers. We've shrunk the field of play for them. It's shrinking for them, which is good. They need to hear that. They need to get out of that absurdity, that absurdist role of trying to be greater than God, saying, I know the way to fixate freedom. There is no way to fixate freedom. Okay, so they don't know the way. You can't know the way to do the impossible. You can be very clever with labels about it and game it very cleverly, but in the end, it's just a waste of time. It's just an utter waste of time. That's all that it is. So we've shrunken their playing field. So for those who are practicing the wow practice, they can no longer play with you. Okay. You're not on that playing field anymore. You're not on that playing field. And that's a huge relief, isn't it? Huge relief. You can't be messed with anymore. You're not on that playing field. Because we've defined the playing field, our playing field. And they can't play on that field. They cannot play on that field. So the role of the Dharma Kings cannot be usurped at all. Cannot be. No one can. Nobody can. No one can pull rank on them at all. Very important. Sri Sri Anandamaya Maharaj Maharshi helped us with this so much. Jamyang Kenji Choki Lodo too. His humility, his total humility, you know. So we have them and we know they cannot be usurped. No usurper can come in and usurp them. Cannot. So we have that stability. We have that supreme stability here. Supreme stability. And thank God for that. And the resistance, of course, is those, you know, those arrogant ones who still want to try and fixate freedom and be, you know, create a new reality and be the god of the new reality. You know, they resist shrinking their playing field. You know, they want to be, you know, lord over all, the highest over all of us. They want to enslave all of us, actually. And so in the, you know, with shrinking the playing field, that gives them a lot of insecurity. They feel very insecure. They think their security comes from fixating reality and then enslaving all of us and them being the top. And so when they see that their playing field is shrinking, they feel insecure. The insecurity comes back up again. So, yeah, they don't like it. That is true. So it's been very difficult to get to this because there is some resistance. Spirit still has some resistance. But the resistance of spirit is lessening. It's lessening. It's lessening. It's lessening. It's melting. It's thawing out. Spirit's going through this thawing out. So, you know, the spirit of remaining arrogance failed to block this. It failed to block this. Thank God. Okay, failed. And now its playing field has shrunk dramatically. It will shrink dramatically in the future. It will shrink dramatically. Which is good, because they'll, at some point they'll give it up. Give up their, you know, trying to do the impossible too. There's nowhere else to go. There's nowhere else to go. So, as playing field shrinks for them, they're forced to deal with their insecurities. They'll be forced to, they have no choice but to, the insecurities will rise for them again, and then they have to choose once again whether they're going to try and lord it over all of us or be humble and get down to true practice. Okay, they'll have to choose once again, and ultimately all of us will choose to allow all insecurities to go into total remission through dropping, trying to change reality. We'll drop that attempt to try and change reality. We'll stop hallucinating the absence of reality. And then we'll experience the total equality of all reality. Total equality. Total freedom. Total equality of all. So if you're still trying to set your goal too high, you're vulnerable to these manipulators. You're very vulnerable. You're very vulnerable. Okay? So that's why we're capping it here. And then that takes the vulnerability. You're off that playing field. You're off that playing field just like that. And then you're really able to build confidence that you're the star of your practice. You become the star of your practice, and there's no greater star of your practice, and there never will be. There never will be. You will always be the ultimate star of your practice. And I'm the spokesperson for that position. Okay, I'm the one spokesperson for that position, that you will always be the ultimate star of your practicing in this wild practice. So I'm just in the wow of all this. The grace of it all and the effectiveness of it all is, you know, very stunning, very shocking, very stunning. So I have to be in the wow of it and not try to extrapolate to the success of it. Like, imagining, this is what's going to happen. I have to have faith. I know it will be super successful down the road. But I put all this down the road. We have 6 months to thaw out to this. So I can just wow this for 6 months. I have 6 months to just be in the wow of this. That's okay. And help make you, you know, aware of it somehow. I don't know how that will play out. It'll, you know, 6 months before we really kick off something. We have 6 months to thaw out, and then we'll see. September 23rd is a great date for us. So we have a date, and let's see how much we can thaw out by that date. But we're not putting the pressure on ourselves to really get into full swing with this yet. No, we have to thaw out to this. This is that we're quite stunned that we have something like this. You know, that grace has come through for us in such a tremendous that we have the big boost that I said was coming. We have it. I said that I've been working on this big boost. I said the big boost will arrive here. I'm sure of it. I just didn't know exactly what it would be, so I couldn't really tell you, you know, what is this going to be. Now we have it. We have it. So now we have to thaw out to this fact that the big boost is indeed here. Wow, practice is here. It is really here. So by all means, you know, get in touch with me at this thawing out period. You know, go through this thawing out, 6 month thawing out period. There's no pressure on you except to thaw out to this, thaw out to this. Maybe I'll just go play golf for 6 months. I don't know. Yeah, possible. I'm checking my back this morning, you know, because I swung the golf club yesterday. It always makes you feel sore, I mean. But I realize how many times you swing the golf club in a round of golf? 36 times, basically, right? And the rest is chipping and putting. It doesn't put a strain on you. So why am I swinging a golf club 100 times? You never do that in a round of golf. That's putting too much strain. I should just practice every day 36 swings. 14 swings with a driver or a four wood, and then 14 swings with an iron or a hybrid. In par fives there's four with a hybrid or a fairway club, and so I can break it down into exactly how many swings I'll be taking in a round of golf and just do that every day, and then see, you know, get my body used to that. We got a driving range just making full swings like 120. That's crazy. You never do that in a round of golf. There's only 18 holes. Four of them are par threes, and you're just hitting an iron. So a full swing with a driver, the most you'll ever do on a golf course is 14. 14 swings. That's it. So what are you doing taking like 100 swings with a driver at a driving range? That's crazy. See, we're putting expectations too high. Too high. And it's ruining us. Just do 14. That's it. And then you can do four fairway woods, because on par fives you'll be hitting a fairway wood probably, or a hybrid. So do four of those, okay, in your practice. And then 14 plus 4, 18 iron shots. Because you're hitting four iron shots on the par threes, or hybrids. And then 14 on the rest of the holes, the rest of the 14 holes. Because you'll be hitting an approach shot on the par fives with an iron. And then on the par fours, you'll also be hitting an approach shot with an iron. So 18 iron shots. And 18 either drivers or fairway wood shots. So it's 18 and 18 between irons and woods. So, okay. Yeah, there you go. And then chipping and putting is the rest of it. So there you go. I'll take maybe... maybe 12 driver swings and 6 fairway wood swings, because some holes I'm off the tee, I might want to hit a fairway wood. So 12 and 6, something like that. Or I can break it up into 9 and 9, actually. 9 drivers, 9 fairway woods. Let's do that. 9 and 9. And then between hybrids and irons, do 9 and 9 between hybrids and irons. Because some longer par fours should be hitting hybrids into. So 9 and 9 between fairway, hybrids, and irons. And then the rest is putting and chipping. So there you go, 9, 9, 9, 9. Beautiful. See how simple that is? Much wiser approach. Much wiser approach to practice. Just do that every day. And that won't then wipe out your back. Won't wipe my back out. It's again, the whole approach to practice is crazy. You know, the driving range, what? That ruins you. That ruins you. You go out there and you see guys slugging a whole bucket of balls with their driver. And they might hit 60, you know, full-on 60 shots. Well, how are you going to feel the next day for a week? You're going to feel like a, you know, truck ran over you. That's not signaling what you're going to do at all on the course. And especially if you want to play golf every day, you can't do that. You have to minimize the strain to your body with golf. Golf puts a tremendous strain on your body. Just like spiritual practice puts a strain on you. So you have to minimize the strain. The wow practice minimizes the strain on you. It's just wow. We don't do any other practice. It's just wow. Now, you might say that's the heart of it. That's the heart of it. Okay. And we could say, wow, I'm already there. The already there is part of the wow practice because that brings the wow up. It helps focus in on the totality of the wow. So there's ancillary practices that bring us clearly to the wow practice. But the wow practice is really the only practice we do. That's all that's needed. But we have to realize that's all. We have to trend towards. So there's ways to trend towards the wow practice. But with just one practice here, and then trending towards that is necessary for all of us. There's none of us are just going to start out saying wow, and that's it. And then, you know, because we keep saying, well, maybe I need to do more. So we'll be trending. There's ways to trend towards getting better and better at the wow practice, to being a Dharma prince. So this trendingness takes the pressure off of us also, doesn't it? You're just trending towards being a Dharma prince. And ultimately, Dharma prince is one who's very skillful in the wow practice. And has really got it. And it's very practiced with tremendous familiarity to it. Tremendous familiarity to it. And then maybe we don't even need to be most honorable spokesers. Maybe we just say Dharma Prince. I don't know. I'm trending towards clarifying that. You know, when you reach the goal of total remission of all insecurity, then you know what are you then at that point? You know, well, most honorable Dharma Prince or something like that. Yeah, most honorable Dharma Prince. And since this is truly beyond all gender, we wanted to stick with that neutral, just one neutral term, Dharma Prince. We'll use that for now. Most honorable Dharma Prince. And if you're female, you can be most honorable Dharma Prince too. When total remission of all insecurity arises, you know, you will see. We will know by the time you get there. But you'll first be a Dharma Prince first, which means really, you're getting it. The practice is being very effective for you. And you'll understand how important it is that to use this neutral term to have it masculine. There's a reason why we've used that throughout history, the tradition. All the wise ones used it. Nanda Maima used it. The he, okay? Very important to get away from all the effort to structure, which is centered on the feminine. At the heart of the effort to structure reality, the spirit, the heart of that is time, space, process, and form, which is symbolized by the feminine giving birth to structure. So you want to trend away from that. So that's why the neutral pronoun of success, if you want to refer to yourself as some way, we use the he pronoun. It helps us trend away from the belief in structuring, that the structuring is possible. See, the feminine is the belief that structuring reality is possible. And then the masculine comes up to help ingenuity into making it possible. So the basic faith that structuring reality is possible is what we call the feminine. And the ingenuity of trying to do this then is a lot of that burden is put on the masculine to be inventive and ingenious in how to structure it, to come up with it. But the basic faith that we can structure reality is what we call the feminine. So that's the most powerful, okay, in terms of pushing this dream, the faith that it's possible. Without that, dream would stop, okay? So we have to trend away from the feminine, that faith that structuring is possible. You have to trend away from that. So again, that's why tradition has been the way it is, religious tradition. It's grounded in wisdom. Absolutely it is. And so we absolutely are sticking with that. And when you become a Dharma prince and you start to see, there won't be any objection at that point at all. You will see, oh my gosh, that how true that is. How true that is. So spirit, is the most reluctant to give up faith that it can be done. It's willing to give up attempts to do it. Okay. But the final backing away from it is to give up even any faith at all that it can happen. And that's the final. And that's the most difficult to back away from. So you certainly don't want to try to back away from that first at all. So as you're walking it back, you walk it back. We use the male pronoun, okay, like that. We do not say he, she. We do not do that here, okay? That's set in stone here, set in titanium. We do not get on that slippery slope at all. Because that puts way too much pressure on you, because then you're trying to overcome all faith in the dream. That's way too difficult to do. Starting out, way too difficult to do. And we don't aim for that. We aim for total remission of all insecurity. Okay, total remission. So this takes the faith thing off the plate for us. It takes it off the plate. We are not messing with that at all here. So again, very traditional. In the whole gender thing, we're very traditional in that, and rightly so, rightly so, because that's what's effective. So yeah, females practice this. Say, I'm aiming to be a Dharma prince. So let's put that as a convention. I'm aiming to be a Dharma prince. Now, those who are trying to do too much, say, what are you talking about? You got to be a princess. No. That's off the plate. It's off the plate. So we're taking that off the plate, because that's faith that structuring freedom is possible without any evidence, just blind faith. It's too difficult to struggle with that. We're not aiming for that. See, that puts too much pressure on you. And that's what we call the feminine, is faith that is possible. That's just a dream. The feminine, masculine, this whole thing is just a dream of spirit trying to fixate freedom. That's all it is. The feminine body and the male and female bodies are just inert, neutral, inert appearances. There's nothing to them at all, actually, except they're being dreamed. They're just stick figures. So the pragmatic approach, therefore, is totally justified here. Totally justified. And it's set in stone here, okay? Set in titanium, set in diamond. It's Vajra. This is a Vajra convention, a diamond convention here. And we're holding on to traditional values. And trend towards fidelity, okay? In whatever relationships you have, fidelity, okay? Which means marriage. And no divorce, no divorce, okay? We're trending towards that. For most modern people, they think, oh, I'm in an open relationship. No, we're trending towards just one partner, if you're gonna have a partner, or if even better, just no partners at all. But not actually equal. I mean, to have no partners at all and have just one partner, it's just equal. It's equal. But and we're trending towards no divorce. No divorce. Okay, that's traditional. The divorce is absolute no-no traditionally, okay? Because you want your life to be boring. You want your external, cultural, social life to be boring. Very important. So it doesn't attract you away from your practicing. So of course in marriage it gets very boring. Which is great. Which is super helpful. So you absolutely want to take yourself off out of the playing field of special relationships, that whole thing. I'm married, I'm in a committed relationship, and that's it. And I'm sticking with it. And of course, the attraction will come out of it, and all the fire will come out of it, and all the passion will go away, and it'll become very boring, which is great. That's exactly what you want. It may take a while, but sometimes it's pretty quickly. It's like, oh my gosh, this isn't what I thought would make me happy, which is great, because we're not looking for any happiness in external circumstances, our conditions, our culture at all. We want that culture to be flat and boring, flat and boring. That's exactly what's effective, because then we can turn our attention to this practice. And so I've experienced this myself. And it works. It absolutely works. Absolutely works. That's what you want. So you want your partner to be a very boring partner, very traditional partner, not trying to fire you up in any way. And therefore, clothing and appearance, we want to be boring. Okay? Want it to be drab and boring. You do not want to try and spice up your special relationship at all. You do not want to try and spice it up. You know, so we want to trend towards flat, boring look. No makeup. Just don't dye your hair. Don't make it all fancy. Just complete boring look. Okay? Have a boring look to you. That's wonderful. And blessed are those who have their partners just two boring people in a committed marriage. That's the best. That's the best. That's the best. That's super helpful. Super helpful. You know, marriage is till death does us part. There's a reason. Because that's most effectively, that's the grace of God being very effective for you. You want to lose interest in the body. You want to lose interest in sensations. You want to lose interest in innovating sensation. Absolutely. Jesus says, ultimately, the body, you shouldn't have any feeling one way or the other to the body at all. It should be just like neutral. Neutral. We want to trend towards no drugs. Okay, no drugs. Trending towards no drugs. Because that's trying to innovate the inner landscape. We don't need any innovation. We have the wow. All innovation is over with here. Because the sum total of all innovation, we already have it. We already have it. So trend towards no drugs. Okay. Trend towards a committed relationship, a boring committed relationship. Trend towards a boring social life, a boring house. Okay. Trend towards a boring house, a boring car, a boring life. Just you know, sort of drab, steady, drab, boring. You know, that then liberates you for more and more practice. This is what I have been able to determine here. What a wonderfully boring life I have. But the fact is, that's just external. But the path of practicing has just been unbelievably dynamic and wowish. Unbelievably wowish. Cannot put it into words. Because success, more and more and more and more success has come to me. So much so, I at times I'm just staggering along. Staggered by it. Usually I'm staggered by it, actually. Continuously staggered by it now, that's for sure. There's no way you could put that into a cultural context. The success you have on the spiritual path cannot be put into cultural innovation. It cannot. Cannot. That's the loser's game that they're playing. A game of continuity fear and bias. That's a game of bias. You don't need that game anymore. Cannot be put into cultural success. Cannot. So we just keep culture same old, same old, same old, boring. Same old, same old, same old, boring. Yeah, we can play around at golf, do something, a few activities, go hiking, sure. Keep it boring. Keep it simple. Keep it really simple. Trend toward very simple. Not innovating. Not innovating. And not having any, and not having faith that any innovation is going to work. Those two go hand in hand. But the first you have to trend towards dropping the innovation, because again, dropping the faith is too difficult for us. That's the final thing that will ever happen is we'll finally let go of the faith. But that's not our goal. That is not our goal here. Our goal is a total remission of all insecurities. Total remission. But not totally dropping it. Total remission. It's like your cancer's in total remission. You feel perfect. But you're not claiming you're cancer free. It's in remission. It's in remission. Now, I've noticed that those who have been healed, they've taken this wise approach. They say, no, I'm not cancer free. I say, you're well. I say, no. I talked to somebody who beat cancer, really. Well, not beat it, but it was in remission. He said, no, I'm not cancer free, but I am in total remission. And I feel great. I said, wow. That's your mental, you took this right mental approach, didn't you? And just like alcoholics or someone with addiction, they never say, I beat it. So we never say we beat it. Okay, we're not here to beat anything. We're here to be in total remission of all insecurities. We're not defeating our insecurities at all. Not at all here. That word defeating, triumphing, is not allowed here. We are simply allowing our insecurities to go into total remission. And that's it. So addicts who have been, you know, allowed it to go in their addiction to go into remission, they never say, I defeated it. It's in remission, total remission. But for the rest of my life, that's how I'm going to see it. And you know what? They're the ones who will remain in remission. They will remain in remission. And they'll feel perfect. They'll feel wonderful. They'll feel wonderful. So I learned this lesson the hard way. My dad helped me out with this. My dad's been very helpful to this whole great practice we have. He's very helpful for all of this. And he needs to realize this at some point. He's in the afterlife now. He needs to realize this because he made the cardinal mistake of trying to defeat cancer. It went into remission through the grace of Sri Sri Ananda Maima and the Dharma Kings. I gave him the grace of the Dharma Kings. He accepted it, super terrible cancer, in several days was in remission, and in a week it was in total remission. And I told him, just accept that and just live with it, that it's in remission. And he did for a while, and then it crept back into him. He said, but if I completely defeat it, I'll be like a super guru. I'll be a guru, a Dharma king. And so he tried to be a Dharma king. And when he tried to do that, it roared back. The cancer came roaring back on him and killed him. The body, you know. It's horrible. Really terrible. And I gave him the right advice. Absolutely, I gave him the right advice. I said, no. My advice to you from the Dharma Kings is just live with it in total remission. And if he had done that, he would still be alive. He'd be pretty old at this point. But I believe he'd still be alive, and he would have had a tremendous, beautiful, peaceful life. You know, he was fabulous. But he did not understand how severe the problem is, and he got pumped up by prophecies that he was going to be some great Dharma king, and he tried to fulfill that role, you know, for the world. He didn't need to. I tell him, you don't need to. I'm here. And I'm bringing through this better way. Okay, I'm taking the pressure off you. I'm here to take the pressure off of you. You don't need to be a Dharma King. But he tried to be a Dharma King. And that's so. I learned this lesson the hard way. The really hard way. Lost my dad to that. And like I said, you know, what a wonderful spirit he was. You know, really miss him. I miss that spirit. You rarely come across anyone like that. He was so dharmic. And with such a great humor and sparkle to him, you know. And a liveliness to it all. But unfortunately, he thought that he could push that into being a Dharma king. And you can't do that. It doesn't work that way. The continuity fear is way too severe for that. Way too severe. Way too severe. So none of us should try to push into being a Dharma King here. None of us. Not one of us. Because if there's a Dharma King in this world, they're already a Dharma King. Okay? So in terms of practicing, that should never be the goal for any of us. Dharma King has no need for practice, actually. They come into the world already perfect in that way, you know. They have no faith whatsoever that reality can be structured. No faith whatsoever. They're born that way. Okay. For the rest of us, we must not try to be a Dharma King in this life. We must cap our expectations to just total remission of all insecurity. We must cap our expectations. So this is the key, one of the key elements we have here. Not negotiable at all. Totally non-negotiable. So again, I'm working to help my dad in the afterlife. I hope that he can see that this takes the pressure off of him. Takes the pressure off. He was under too much pressure. He told me that. He was under just horrible pressure from those who were expecting him to be a Dharma King. You know, they wouldn't sell for anything less because they didn't understand also the severity of the continuity fear. And they were demanding it of him. So he had to defeat the cancer in order to claim that he was a Dharma King, because that's what they wanted. But with this practice now, we don't, that's all now, we're off that playing field entirely. And everyone is invited to this playing field, okay, to this playing field. And ultimately, everyone will come to this general playing field, for sure, capping the expectations. But and at the same time, you are the superstar of your practice, okay? You will be a superstar. You will be a superstar. You will be a Dharma prince, okay? A superstar of practicing. Superstar of practicing. And your all insecurities for you will go into remission at some point. They will. They will. So we're having success here with this external hard drive taping smoothly, which is, it came around just at the right moment. Just at the right moment, the Holy Spirit said, hey, you know, go ahead and do it this way. This will work for you. And of course, I wanted to fail, so I wasn't doing it that way. I mean, I was worried about the pressure on me. So I was using something that wasn't working right. It was erratic. So finally I said, oh, what the heck, okay. I tried it, and it was working totally smoothly, so I can't fail now. So, okay, good, we're good. I've been put under so much pressure that if I don't succeed at this, you know, I'm in dire, I don't have any fallback position, no safety net. So, you know, it's a do or die situation for me, so that helps cut through the procrastination. So, we have this wonderful six-month thawing out period here. So, I'll ease into how that's being done. Now, of course, there will be objections, and we're capping the Dharma Kings. We're capping them at seven, all right? You know, are there other Dharma Kings? Yes. Okay, yes. But it puts too much pressure on us to try and identify them all, okay? And we waste time on that. So if there are other Dharma kings, there are those that are meant to follow them and do the practice that they represent, and the spokesperson for them, whatever that happens to be. We here have our Dharma kings who have funneled this practice to us, right here, right now. So we're capping it at seven. Without at all, and we don't have to identify others. We're not in that game at all. Also don't ask me, is someone else a Dharma king? Irrelevant to our practice. We have seven, okay? And we're secure in those seven. Very secure in those seven. Are you kidding me? Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Langchenpa, Jamyang Kenshi, Chogyi, Lodro, Jesus Christ, Ananda Mai Ma, and Ram Maharshi. We're secure in those seven Dharma kings. But again, if someone else wants to follow another Dharma king, it's irrelevant to us. It's irrelevant to us here. It's not relevant to us. So we don't really have any comment about it at all. But we bless them. We bless them. Bless them. Recognizing that, yeah, there can be other Dharma kings, but that game, we're not playing that game. The game of other, we're not playing that anymore. We have our practice. Because the sum total of even all Dharma kings is wow. And we already have the wow. Okay? And so our Dharma kings have accepted this, that the sum total of all practice and the sum total of all Dharma kings is wow. And so they're humble enough to give us this. You see? These Dharma kings have given us this practice out of their great humility. And saying even the sum total of all these seven Dharma kings is just wow. That's it for us. That's it. That's all they ask for. That's all they ask from us to them is just give them the wow. Just do that for them. That's all we have to do for them is just accept the wow. That's it. That's all they ask of us. And so these seven Dharma kings have given us this practice. So we're capping. This practice is capped on those seven Dharma kings who have agreed to accept the wow from us as our grace to them, as our interaction with them. Just the wow. That's it. No more interaction is required of us. We don't have to, do anything in relationship to these Dharma kings except practice the wow. That's all they ask of us. Nothing more. Nothing more. Again, if you don't cap it, you're putting too much pressure on yourself. Then you're waiting. Waiting game, too much confusion, too much pressure. You're straying into faith area. Okay, trying to do too much. Do too much. You're over practicing, in other words, and you'll quit. Like if I went out and hit 200 golf balls every day, you know what? If I did that every day, I'd ruin my back, and I wouldn't be able to play golf anymore. I'd quit for a year or something. So you have to cap it. And again, all this asks of you is just accept the wow. And that put and they are our Dharma kings here, our seven Dharma kings, guaranteed that if you do that, one day you will ultimately, they guarantee your ultimate success. They're the guarantors of it. Okay? You don't need any more guarantors than them. You don't need to make any start. It's already 100% guaranteed. 100%. So why keep adding on to 100%? That's redundant. Now, because we're trying to do the impossible, we believe in redundancy will work. So that's why I'm using seven, capping it at seven, and not just one. I could use just Longchamp, but he already guaranteed my ultimate success. He's already guaranteed it. But because of we believe we're so familiar with redundancy, trying to hit our head against the wall, we think we just hit our head against the wall of impossibility enough times, it will work. I realized that we can't just do away with redundancy entirely, but we do have to cap it. We absolutely have to cap it, or we will continue on with that madness. Okay, so I've capped it at seven, and they've capped it at seven. So it's capped. Anything beyond that is, again, starting to stray into absurdist redundancy. You have to cap it somewhere, and since they let them decide that. Let them decide that. They've capped it at seven for this particular practice. That's enough redundancy. Don't need to make it eight or nine or ten or something like that, right? Because then there's no breaks on that slope. Our habit is so terrible of redundancy. We have such an absurdist habit of redundancy that we have to just, with faith, with our faith in the Dharma Kings, allow them to cap it for us. Because if we don't cap it, then we will most certainly stray into thinking, feeling that we have to be the Dharma Kings and defeat faith in possibility. You know, then that whole thing, that whole playing field now is in play. So we want to get off of that playing field. And again, thawing out to this is required. And I know this gives people like, but there's a thawing out that has to happen to this, to the wisdom of it. To realizing this will actually work. And I have to be the superstar of my practice. There's no other way. And the wow is my practice. And I have to be the superstar. Not even the Dharma Kings are the superstar of your practice. You're even above them in terms of your practice. You are the superstar. Okay. But in order to be the superstar, you have to accept these conventions. Okay, you have to accept those. You have to thaw out towards those. Basic conventions need to be accepted. And then the trends, you need to thaw out your trends, meaning all your habits need to trend towards wow practice, more and more wow practice. It's like you get married. There's just one beautiful or a wonderful person you thought, oh, that would make my life so happy if I marry them, you know, and it just, and you don't marry them, you marry someone who's boring. And for a while, you know, just like, you kind of like be down in the dumps about it, like, wow, I married this boring person, I'm going to have a boring life. It's capped, now it's all capped, I'll never be with them. And fact is you won't. I mean, I actually experienced that. I've been through that, and for a while I was just really bummed out about it. But gradually I start practicing, I start having success, I start saying, wow. I feel like my life is like really blessed, actually. And yeah, I'm you know, so you may not be happy for a long time about that, you know, like really commitment. When you make a commitment, you're going to have these regrets will linger. They'll linger on in the background. It will. If only I'd gone with them, maybe I would have been a Dharma King. It would be so exciting and everything. And I've capped my expectations, you know. But as you practice, you will start having success. And you'll start saying, holy cow, this is quite amazing. I'm way better at this than I thought I was. And then so gradually your regrets will diminish over time. You'll trend towards no regrets. You'll trend in that direction. For sure, I've been through it all. This is how it works. But initially, you will have some regrets, no doubt about it. You will. See, oh, you know, over there, oh, that's, oh, over there, oh, you know. It's like you get married and you're still thinking, did I make the right decision, you know, and... Oh, look at them. Maybe they would have been better. I don't know. What did I do? What did I do? What did I do? Crazy. I mean, look at how the field still looks so beautiful. You know, it's just, wow. What did I do? I opted for a boring life. Yeah. That's the key, you know, key step you take. You opt for a boring life. On the surface. On the surface. But beneath the surface, you've opted for a spectacular, a superstar life, actually. So what you're really opting for is a superstar life. And that's what I did. I opted to be a superstar. And I said, okay, that's what I opted. I'll do it. That's what I really wanted. And that's what you opt to be a superstar. But on the surface, you're opting to be boring. Boring life. That field, in that field, you'll seem to be very boring. You know, in that field of trying to do too much, the field of failure, really, I seem to be very boring. I don't even show up on that field. I'm not even part of that field. I'm like a ghost. You know, people don't even, those who are playing that on that field don't even recognize me at all. I go around like I'm invisible. Invisible. So you're opting to be invisible on that playing field, but on the playing field of being a true superstar, you're on that playing field. And then you're recognizing others on that playing field. Oh my gosh, you know, wow, I'm on this playing field. And I'm getting familiar of being on this playing field. How fabulous is that? So inwardly, you know, you're trending towards being a superstar. And outwardly, you're trending to be just a blah nobody. Which is great. Which one do you really want? You can't have both, really. You cannot have both. You can't play on both playing fields. If you're trying to be a super failure, you cannot play on the playing field of being a super success. You cannot. You have to choose between the two. So if you're not willing to cap your expectations, then you got nowhere to go except try to be a Dharma king this lifetime, and you will fail. You will fail at that. You will absolutely fail at that. So you're on the playing field of failure. And so we are choosing to be on the playing field of success. Superstar. We're superstars, but not a Dharma king. There's nothing we can say about a Dharma king that can translate effectively to us, okay? So they're off the playing fields altogether, actually. So they're even off the playing fields of super success, superstar. They're off that playing field entirely. So, but we can be superstars, super successful. We're on that playing field. And the others are on the playing field of super failure. All right. And if that's what, you know, floats their boat, actually, it sinks their boat. And if they think sinking their boat to the bottom of the ocean of doubt and fear, which is ultimately trying to use total mental chaos to succeed, it doesn't succeed. And I know it doesn't succeed because I experienced it. That gave me the leverage over the entire situation. So they'll, you know, super failure, they're going to be super failures, well, guess what? Even that being a super failure is insecurity. They're even insecure in that. They'll still be insecure in that. So get off of that. You have to decide which playing field you're going to play on. You can't play on both. You cannot play on both. If you say you can play on both, you're trying to be a super failure. And that's ultimately not really possible. It's just an absurdist position, actually, because you'll never succeed in that way in getting free of insecurity. You can never fixate insecurity. Okay? You can never fixate insecurity. That too is insecure. So there are those who play that game, so I can do both. What they mean is I can succeed. I can fixate insecurity. And they're completely wrong about that. And see, I know that for a fact, so this puts me in a very position of tremendous leverage over the whole situation to be helpful as the spokesperson for the Dharma Kings, because I found that out through direct experience, that mental chaos, imaginary mental chaos, does not fixate insecurity at all. And at that point, I realized I have no choice, no choice at all except to be a superstar, be super successful, be a Dharma prince. I had no choice at all. So I had to get on the playing field of success instead of the playing field of failure. Had to. And realized you can't do both. No. That's just an absurdist position, that saying that we can fixate insecurity. So we can have stability and both stability and insecurity. So that when they say they can do both, they mean we can be stably insecure. And we can't even do that. No, we cannot, because the mind is free. And instantly, we can drop that too. Because that's just imagination. You know, that's just a play of mind. And so I don't have to say who the Dharma princes are in the world. Again, I don't have to say who the gurus, Dharma. No, that's not our playing field. Because I'm saying you are the superstar. You are the superstar. Each one of you that is practicing the WOW, you are the superstar of your practice. And we don't need to worry about any other Dharma princes or gurus or where is somebody else on the path, all this nonsense. You are the superstar of your path. The superstar of WOW. Okay? You are the superstar of WOW on your path. And that's all there is to it. That's all there is to it. So you don't need to be seeking and evaluating and judging other people at all. So there's no more whatabouts. What do you think about? There's no more what do you think about this teacher? No, you are the superstar. Okay? That's above teachers. You're above teachers. Because you're doing what the Dharma kings, you're giving the one thing the Dharma kings ask of you, to give to them, that what they gave to you, you've accepted this. So you're above the gurus, the teachers, all of that. You're above you're above that already by practicing the WOW. And the only ones that are above you are the Dharma kings. That's it. And there's nothing we can say about their position at all that will make any sense whatsoever. Nothing at all we can say that we can about their position that we can understand at all. Okay? So you see how this is like smoothing out your entire mental landscape of expectations. We're smoothing out your expectations here. Thawing, and in 6-month thawing out period here, we have this grace period here that I'm recognizing for the big boost that we're bringing in. The big WOW boost. Yeah. So you can say, I'm on the playing field of the big WOW boost. And the spokesperson for this is Dharma Prince Clarity Ross is the spokesperson for this. The spokesperson for the Dharma Kings is the Dharma King practice that we're using. And so he's just helping put it into words and helping us, you know, cap our expectations. In order to cap expectations, you got to say, what are the expectations I'm capping and how am I capping them? So I'm just explaining. I'm giving the clarification to you what the big WOW boost is all about. And you can say, I'm an apex WOW yogin. You want to say that? I'm an apex WOW yogin. Again, you are the superstar. And only the Dharma Kings are higher than you. Okay? On your path, I'm not as high as you are. You're higher than I am on your practicing. And you're higher than all the gurus and the Dharma princes, everything. Only the Dharma kings are higher than you are. And again, there's nothing at all we can say about their position. So we've capped our expectations of explanation right there. Okay? And you have to thaw to this. I'm very aware of those who think that they can do more in this attitude. And of course, that is still on the playing field of failure. And ultimately, that's trying to defeat faith. You know, get rid of all faith that we can do the impossible. If you did that, you couldn't reign in this world for long at all. And everything would disappear for you. I mean, you would be directly leaping. Into total flow of reality, and our familiarity fear is so severe that to do that it would just be a sheer anomaly. Okay, and the anomalies do not have to be set into any context at all. Okay, so we don't need to talk about it at all. You cannot set an extreme anomaly into any context. To do so makes the term extreme anomaly superfluous, meaningless. So if extreme anomalies arise, that's not our concern in the slightest bit. In the slightest bit. So we don't even need to address that. There's no context to address that at all. And since we do have to establish some context, that's, again, off the plate entirely. So we can talk then directly, saying that those are trying to do too much. I'm aware of that. I feel it. And those who are trying to make me the superstar of their path, I can feel it. See, that's wrong. See, that's not part of our practice at all. You are the superstar. And so you have to carry yourself as a superstar. So when you carry yourself as a superstar, you're very benevolent and magnificent to others. So you deign to be gracious towards me. You deign to be gracious towards me because you are the superstar and I'm lower than you are. But I'm on this playing field, very securely on this playing field. So it's not that you're coming, if you see me, it's not that you're seeing someone superior. You know, you're greater than I am. But you have to be that greatness. Very magnanimous, very gracious, very magnanimous, very humble in your greatness. Okay, you must be very humble, like that. So I know I can sing really well. I'm very musical. I'm very praiseworthy of other singers. And say, oh, how great they are, how wonderful they are. I just love it, like this and this and this and that, like that. Just 1 second, yeah.
Mom is busy again.
Oh, okay. Just...
She wants you to get her breakfast.
Okay, all right, thank you. Okay, so it's like that. Yeah. So it's required of you to be the magnanimous one. Okay, you are the superstar. You are the superstar, not me. Of your own path. So, in relation to me, you can be silent because you know I can help remind you that you are the superstar. So I'm helpful, very helpful in that role. So you might want to just be silent. So I can help you stabilize, help you keep, remember, you are the superstar. When you do this wild practice, you are the superstar of your path, for sure. And you're directly, only the Dharma kings are above you because you've accepted their practice. And this is all you have to give them. The exchange between the two of you, the relationship between the two, it's through this practice. So I just remind you of that fact. So you want to be very humble, in a very gracious, humble mood, to be reminded of what a superstar you really are. Okay? So I being aware that I'm a superstar, I can remind you that I'm the superstar of my path, I can remind you that you're the superstar of your path. Okay, so that's the attitude in relation to me that you need to have, that you're royalty, okay? Royalty is very gracious, very gracious. They can afford to be, right? And then to be reminded that you are a superstar of your path, you can get, you can be very much in a very good listening, receptive mode to be reminded of that. So it's pretty simple, right? Pretty simple. Okay. I have to render some assistance as another crisis has arisen. But we're powering through this in the most wowish way. 6 months to thaw out. That's great, isn't it? What's the day? The 19th? That's the 19th. Okay, beautiful. We're right on track here. Right on track. Okay, that's it for this one. Wow.